Welcome to Melbourne, first of all.
Thank you.
I wanted to start with a story that I've read a lot about. I don't know how true it is, that you used to read books while working overnight in a hospital. Is that where you sort of started really reading?
A mental hospital, yeah. I wasn't a big reader as a kid. I was a pretty good student, but I wasn't a big reader. And then I worked my way through college at a mental hospital, and I worked a lot of night shifts, 11 to 7. And mostly at night, most nights people slept. Sometimes it got a little hairy, but mostly people slept. And I was just reading, and I hadn't really read that widely. But at that point, I was reading. I was kind of a literary snob, so it was all Gunter Grass, and read all of the Ulysses and things like that.
Right.
Yeah. So, and then some writers who it really influenced my style, like Evan Connell Jr., who wrote Mr. Bridge and Mrs. Bridge, which are wonderful, by the way, if you've never read those. Very tight chapters, very short chapters. Jerzy Kaczynski, Painted Bird, Snaps, right. Things like that, which are also similarly very short and crisp, and I like that style.
Did you learn much studying English? You've got a degree in it. Did that?
I did.
Did that teach you how to write books?
Apparently not. I was a PhD student at Vanderbilt, which is a really second rate. No, it's a pretty good college in the States. And interestingly, this was during the Vietnam War. And I left Vanderbilt because I had a high lottery number in those days. And you had to get out of school to take advantage of it. Because I really didn't have a desire to go to, especially at the end of, it wouldn't have mattered. I wouldn't want to go at the beginning of that war either, but I especially didn't want to go at the end. but it struck me that I had found something that I loved to do. At that point, I was a voracious reader, and I loved to write. And I felt that if I stayed and completed the graduate school and became a teacher, I felt that I would wind up not loving it as much as I did, that it would work.
It would kill
against
the joy.
It. Yeah, and I would kill it, but it would definitely dilute it. So I said, this is a good time to go do something wonderful like write advertising. I've been clean for 20 years.
Well done. Congratulations. So what's going on when you're writing the Thomas Berryman book that's been re-released, your first one in 76? What's going on in your life? Like, did you have a clear intention when you were writing that?
One of the interesting things about Thomas Berryman, which I think was published in 1976, and it's about hate crimes in the United States, and a lot of riots which had taken place at the end of the 60s, 67, 68, just exactly what's going on now, or pretty close in LA and Detroit, and now it's happening again. And we have a deal with CBS, which is a big network in the United States, and we just shot a pilot based on the Thomas Berryman number, which is bizarre. And Ava DuVernay, who directed Selma, directed the pilot, which was pretty cool. Yeah, she's very bright, and it was a really pleasure to work with her. And now CBS is deciding whether they are going to, put that show on the air. But, we'll see what happens. But it's so fascinating, 100 years later, they go,
still relevant. And you said to me earlier today that was your best book in some ways. What did you mean?
I was just making that up. Yeah. I think it has the best sentences. You'll see there's some really neat. Oh, that's a good sentence.
They're a little longer than some of your.
It's not the length as much. I just think the writing is crisper, but the storytelling I think was not particularly good. And it's kind of a convoluted plot, which it's not a bad thing. Writers love that. Like Michael Connelly, go, that's your best book by far because it's convoluted and hard to follow. And, they like that.
There's a lot of praise in the front of that book for the re-release, Lee Child, Michael Connelly, you mentioned New York Times.
Yeah. Did they put that in there, really?
Yeah, they did.
They're actually writing, they're talking about Alex Cross. It's interesting they would put it in there.
I'm also interested, too, you clearly, I want to get into how incredibly prolific you are, but maybe
I'm writing a book right now. I'm writing one about you. Because well,
there's Rafe, isn't
we
there?
We met today, and yeah. You know, I got a beat on it, yeah.
I was going to ask where all the ideas come from. Yeah. I hope the interviewers don't get murdered. But I do want to ask...
You have to stick around to the ending to find
out. That's exactly right. Yeah. The Alex Cross book that you did an ad for in the 90s seems to me like it's the beginning of exerting some control. Can you just tell that story? Because I think that's interesting.
Yeah, the first Alex Cross book, Along Came a Spider... the American publisher, Little Brown, got very excited about it. And they were going to do a nice printing and really get behind it. And at the time, I was still in advertising. And I said, well, let me try a commercial. And he said, no, we don't do commercials for our books. So I just went and did the commercial anyway. It was very inexpensive. It cost like $1,500 or something, which I said, I can do that. And then I brought it in and they went, oh, well, we really like this.
What was in the ad? Can you describe it?
It was just quotes. It had a little spider dangling down and then little quotes. We had, I forget, Nelson DeMille and a few writers, Ann Rule. And then once they saw it, they went, oh, yeah, let's run it. And then they ran it, and the first week it just jumped up to number whatever, 6 or 7 on the New York Times.
Because people aren't doing ads for books at this stage, really.
There was a funny, they were a little bit, more paperbacks, not hardback. But at that time, I was living in New York City, and there was a big bookstore near the house. And I picked up the New York Times and I saw I was on the list and I said, this has to be a mistake, you know, I can't be, you know. So I went to this big bookstore, and what we'll do, writers, we'll go to the stores and we count the books. And we go, there used to be 15 and now there's 11, you know. This
do
is
you look
so
for
cool.
the little dust marks?
Yeah,
to see
yeah, yeah, the whole
gone.
Ball of wax. And but if you pick up one of our books while we're there, we're watching. Well, this is true. The airport, same thing. When I go to the airport, you know, whenever I go, won't tell you. And I see somebody, we watch. And so anyway, so I'm in this store in New York, and this woman picks up Along Came a Spider, and she's looking at it and going through and reading the fly leaf copy, blah, 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 blah. And she puts it under her arm, and she's walking down the aisle. And I'm, you know... If you put the book down, it breaks our hearts. But if you buy it, it's like, and honest to God, it is exhilarating. And at this point, it was just, I'm over the moon. Like, the pile is down. The New York Times says I'm a bestseller. And this woman puts it on, she's walking down the aisle. She slides it in her pocketbook. She stole it. And all I'm thinking, is that a sale?
Well, it'd get counted, wouldn't it? Because the books go on for their inventory. So you might not get the money, but you get the figure. I actually wanted to ask you about what bookshops that you like. There's a description in your latest Women's Club series, Women's Murder Club. In a time when bookstores are going virtual, this one was what a real bookstore looked like in her dreams. There were blue and white checked floor, thousands of linear feet of bookshelves, comfortable nooks for people to sit and read in, and an inviting performance space where writers could give readings and sign books. Is that like your perfect bookstore?
That'd be a good one.
Yeah.
You know what? I like it when you walk in and you can kind of see where everything is. I like it when they really will. They're not like trying to get you to wander through a maze where you can go, okay, there's the mysteries and there's the nonfiction and there's the sports, whatever. Yeah. So you can kind of go where you want to go as opposed. I like that.
You're a big supporter of bookstores, and I want to get into that in a moment, but you inserted yourself into a bit of the battle with Amazon. I'm just interested. Online,
and
does
I
it
lost.
Make a difference?
Yeah.
But
they
does it make
the
a
hell
difference?
Out of me. Don't fight Amazon. I'll tell you that I haven't really gotten into this too much, but I'm actually writing. You remember Ira Levine? We do like Stepford Wives and Rosemary's Baby and all that stuff. I'm writing that kind of a book now about a mammoth thing, which is called The Store.
Right.
And I swear to God, I am doing this now. I don't know if the publishers will publish it, but it's going to be very cool. I'm almost done. It's very nicely creepy.
Yeah. You mentioned when you did the ad for the book, Along Comes the Spider. I think a few years later is when you go full time. I think that's right, when you leave advertising. I just wonder when, I'm assuming some stage in the 90s you went, yep, this is it. I've worked out, I'm a blockbuster author. I've kind of made it. Did those sort of thoughts come to you in the 90s or not?
That was a piece of it. There were a couple of things. One, I was with J. Walter Thompson, which actually was a very pleasant place to work for a long time. And then WPP bought it, and it became less pleasant. And the culture changed. Right. And it went from a very nice culture, people liked to work there, to a...
Anything like Mad Men?
Literally, the culture became, you know, what does this pencil cost? I mean, right. That was the culture. And that's just not, you know, so that was not the best thing in the world. The other piece of it was when I was in my mid-20s to mid-30s, I was with a woman and she developed a brain tumor and died. And I hadn't been with anybody. And it occurred to me during this period that that was the best thing that had happened in my life, to be with this person. And I haven't done anything. It wasn't that I was going to try to replace her, but I was writing and I was doing all this crazy advertising. And I said, why am I not trying to find somebody? Mm. You know, so I went out looking, and the lovely Susan somewhere is in here, my wonderful wife. So that was the other thing. That was really the biggest
piece
that drove me, to just change my priorities. And then we had a wonderful son who we adore. So that turned out great. But that was more of it, honestly, than anything else.
The successful
sales. Okay, I'm gonna do things differently now.
Yeah. Okay, so the question that I love to know a good answer to.
As opposed to what I've been answering so far?
Well, no. I'm not sure there is. Look, to be honest, I'm not sure there's actually a complete answer you can give. But, I mean, I was really stunned when I looked on your website just to see the schedule. I mean, the output is just incredible. I don't think anyone else puts out as many books as you do.
Yeah.
And I just wonder what the secret is. Is it... What keeps you going?
What keeps me going, I think I mentioned to you. I mean, somebody said it's difficult to find something that you love to do in life, and then it's almost miraculous if you can find, you know, that somebody will pay you to do that. So that is my gig. I grew up in a small town in upstate New York, Rivertown, recently voted the sixth most violent town in the United States, and that was kind of the, you know, my father grew up in a Newburgh poorhouse called the Pogey.
Right.
His mother was a charwoman, which meant she took care of the bathrooms. And for that, she and my father got to live in one room there. So, you know, my background, you know, I've been poor and I've been middle class. And then I was poor again and middle class again. And now I'm rich. And as I look at the whole thing, I like rich better.
Yeah.
But, I'm really happy to have gone through the different stages, both as a human being and a writer, because I think it really has helped. It helps me to understand people. It helps me to understand how difficult, how hard it is.
You don't need to keep writing to stay rich, presumably. Something's driving you to be across all those publications.
You know, it's not. If I'm driven, I don't feel it. I don't feel that I'm particularly hyper about stuff. I don't feel tortured. I sleep very well. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
I mean, you see some people and they're just like...
You don't wake up in the middle of the night
feet
worrying.
Feet are going and, you know, it's like, you know, I'm okay, I'm fine, you know. I don't feel any of that. And I just think it's, as I get older and experience different things, I find certain things that I like a lot and I try to do those and I try to minimize the stuff that I don't like. I don't go to funerals unless I have to. I try not to go out to meals with people that I don't really want to spend time. You know, so I just, it's like, and I love to do this and I love my wife and I love my boy. And we kind of do a lot of that. We don't socialize a ton. We do some, but not a massive amount of socializing. And there's no other that, you know, like, I live in Palm Beach, which in theory is very fancy. You could wear a tuxedo there every night. I've never worn a tuxedo in Palm Beach, so I don't know.
Okay.
Like that.
Tell me how it works.
Did that totally avoid your question?
No, I'm overwhelmed. I struggle to sort of, you know, just keep the family going and do a normal job. You seem to do like 10 at once. I want to know how it works with the co-authors. What's the process? How does it work?
We alternate words. Oh, he is.
Process.
He's out.
You're more experienced at this than I am.
Yeah. But that's the test that we do to either accept a new or reject. And I'm sorry. I generally work with mostly people that I've known for a while. Like Peter DeYoung was the first, and we worked together at Thompson. Peter's a very good stylist. And that was the first time that we did this co-writing thing. And I enjoyed it, and I found that, I mean, I think the best explanation, two things about the collaboration. One is Simon and Garfunkel, Lennon and McCartney, Gilbert and Sullivan, Peter Straub and Stephen King. I mean, it's done a lot. A lot of the cathedrals in Europe, if you go around, you find, oh my God, 20 painters did that, you know. So it's not advertising. It's all teams. We have a book I wrote called Zoo, which is actually, to me, one of the most unique books that I've written. It's one where when I read it, I go like, there's nothing like that. So I think that's cool. We're doing a TV series. We've filmed five or six of them. And before the series started, they took me out to Hollywood and brought me to the writer's room. And, you know, and I get a little bit of flack about the co-writers, but I go to this room and they write these 44-page scripts and there's 10 writers in there, you know? So bizarre. And I'm going like, this is, you know, you guys are worse than I am. 10 writers, everybody writes 4 pages, you know? A little more than 4, actually. It's 44 pages, and there's only 10 of us. Okay. They're so funny out there because, see, in Hollywood, screenwriters are the bottom of the heap, except if a novelist shows up, and then there's somebody below them. So they'll, immediately gang up on the novelist. And so the two senior people, the one guy said, you know, James, you know, not to be insulting, but, you know, Zoo, it's kind of a pulp novel. It's a B novel. But trust me, we're going to do an A-plus job on it, you know. And while I'm thinking, I don't say the line, but I'm thinking it's really too bad that, you know, you didn't get Saul Bellow's Herzog. Could it would have been an A-plus novel, and then you could have done your A-plus work on it, you know. So, yeah.
Has Hollywood been enjoyable?
No.
Not at all?
Now, you know, I'll tell you the best Hollywood thing. I was on The Simpsons. I was a cartoon, still am. And in this episode, Marge is on the beach and she's reading Kiss the Girls. And she's going, oh, I just love James Patterson. And then I'm riding by her on this white horse on the beach. And then we cut and she's on the back of the horse behind me. And it's kind of sweet. And she's going, let's make some nursery rhyme titles, James. And I go, I think there's something cooler we could do than that, Marge. And then this bell goes, and my eyes go, brr. And then the scene is as Marge's bedroom. And she's in bed, and Homer walks in. And Homer says, that was great last night, Marge. But why did you keep calling me James? Yeah. So that's the highlight of my Hollywood career.
But you get.
I sent the day after the show was on. I sent flowers to Marge, at where the Simpsons are created.
Well, nice.
She didn't write back.
Yeah. But you get to meet famous people. You mentioned today you meet people like Bill Clinton. So there's some.
Yeah. No, yeah.
There's
fun. I was on. Sue and I were on the plane once, going up to Washington, and Serena Williams was sitting in front of us. And during the flight, about a dozen people came up and asked her for whatever people asked for. And can I have a tennis racket? Can I have a ball? And at the end of the flight, we got up, and she looked at me and she said, but I want your autograph. And we walked down to baggage together, the three of us. And Serena goes, I can't believe you're James Patterson. I'm going, I can't believe you're Serena Williams. You know, and it was funny. It was a kind of a cool, nice thing. And I actually have made a little bit of a friendship with Kari Webb, who's from here, and she's in Florida a lot. What I love about Kari and the two of us talking together, she's from a small town here, and we're both just sort of like, you know, it's no big deal, you know, whatever. I got lucky writing books. She got lucky. She didn't get lucky, but she's just very good playing golf. And I kind of love that thing. You know, for one of my birthdays, I had about 30 of friends that I'd had over the years, and going all the way back to grade school, and the couple people from grade school, a little cursing coming here, they said, well, this is great. You're still the same asshole you always were, you know? And I liked that. I thought that was terrific, you know? Yeah, right. I write books. For some reason, they're successful and, you know, big deal. You know, I mean, one of the things, you know, like with Jack, who's 17 now, and, you know, he has a famous dad, but he likes the bennies of it, and he's, you know, but he's, it's like, it's no big thing. It's like, and I love that. He's not cowed by it. He doesn't feel like he's got to be a writer, and he won't be a writer, and he's on his own path, which is nice.
Where do all the ideas come from?
And I steal them. You said something interesting today. I thought, so there's a book. I have a folder in my office that's about Yothik. And I just, you know, I'll see something or, I don't know, just a little, or title sometimes, or, you know, one, I wrote a love story that I like called Suzanne's Diary for Nicholas. And where that came from is Sue is my wife shoots about 1 million photographs a day. And we must have about 10 million photographs of Jack. I mean, I'm not kidding. And she puts them in these big books. You know, and a couple of the books were sitting there. And I was going through one of the books one day. And he was still little. He's whatever. He was 3 or 4. And I thought, you know, how sad it is that at some point Jack will be looking through this book and we'll both be, you know, we won't be there. And then I had this much more horrible thing, which the idea if Jack wasn't there and we were looking through this book, and you know, and that's where that idea for Suzanne's Diary for Nicholas came from.
You know, but that's obviously your real skill is you have these little thoughts, you hear little snippets of conversation, and you're able
and
to
you
turn that
into a plot.
And you
feel that there's a story there. I really feel I could turn almost anything into a story. My gift is the big imagination and the ability to step back and go that one. The weakness is not enough patience to really take it maybe as far as it could be. Okay. I'll sort of go like, okay, that's great. Next book, you know.
So do you feel like you've still got your best work yet to come?
No, because I feel that this is my trap. I won't. Yeah, maybe I, you know, I don't know, that I would really sit down and really, really, really try to, you know, beat the hell out of one of the books and, you know, do it right.
Is there a favorite type of book you like to write? I mean, you write lots of different
The kids'
genres.
Books.
Yeah?
Yeah. I love the kids' books. I like writing them because I'm allowed to be funny in them. You know, in the thrillers, I mean, you know, it's a serial killer. I mean, it can't get too jokey, you know. but in the kids' books, I think it's really useful to tell stories that I think are good. You know, like we're doing a movie of middle school, the worst years of my life now. We're going to shoot this summer. And
even though you don't like Hollywood.
So far this group is pretty good. The writers are nice and the director seems to be, but they'll turn on me soon, so I hate them, you know. But what that book is really about is it's about kids that kind of get lost in the school system. And this kid in there, Rafe Cacciadori, he's a tremendous artist. But there's not a lot of art and there's not a lot of, they don't get much feedback. So here's a kid who's brilliant in his own way, although he kind of keeps it to himself, and he's not as good in certain other areas, but they don't recognize where he's, you know. So a lot of kids get lost in the system. And they think that they're stupid, and they're not stupid. I mean, their talents are elsewhere. Not all kids, but a lot of kids. So that's what that's about, and we're doing it with Participant, which is a company that they will only do movies that have a social component. Did Inconvenient Truth, and they did Citizen Four, and they did Lincoln, and you know, so and that's what they love about this book is that it is a celebration of these kids that get lost in the system, and you know, but done with humor.
So why are you so passionate about kids reading?
I think part of it has to do with, you know, as individuals, I can't really do anything about global warming, you know, however you feel about it. And I can't, you know, we have a healthcare crisis in the U.S. and I'm not, probably a better situation here. But I can't do much about that. But reading, we actually can all do something about that. One is we can get our kids reading in our own house. And I urge you, if you're having a problem with that, you just have to make it a rule of the house. I'm sorry. I mean, it's like... You mostly make your kids get to the dinner table, especially when they're young. That's the deal. And food is love. Food is love, and it's a good thing. And similarly with books, books are love. So it shouldn't be, well, I made my kid. Like when Jack was eight, Jack is a bright kid. He wasn't a big reader, our son. And that summer we said, you know, you're gonna read every day this summer. And he said, you know, do I have to? And he said, yeah, unless you want to live in the garage. But I said, we're going to get you a lot of cool books. So we went out and got a Percy Jackson, A Wrinkle in Time, and Al Capone Does My Shirts, and a lot of books that, and he went through a dozen of them.
Was it hard to get him to read them?
No, because, I mean, when it came to it, which was rare, but every once in a while, we just, you know, on a certain day, no screens until you read. But mostly that wasn't necessary. And once he got into it, it wasn't necessary at all. But once again, I don't think that's tough love. I just think it's love. And by the end of the summer, he was a very, very good reader. And, you know, and they had the standardized test in the U.S. to get at the colleges and stuff. And an 800 is an extraordinary, it's a perfect score, and it's hard to get. And he got an 800 in reading. So there's what can happen, you know, with a kid who's bright. More important to me are kids who are at risk, who if in fourth and fifth and sixth grades they don't become competent readers, and I don't care whether they become readers for life, but if they don't become competent readers, how are they going to get through high school?
Yeah.
You just can't. You got to get competent. You have to be a great reader. You got to be a decent reader. And if they can't get through high school, what are they going to do in life? I mean, unless they happen to be very lucky and be a wonderful athlete or a wonderful singer or whatever. It's just very, very hard. But once again, the key to me is we can actually do something about that. We can do things in our house to make sure, you know, in most cases, that our kids are good readers.
I'm just curious, how do you know what kids are going to like to read? What do you base that on? Is it the same mental process?
It's just that instinct. You know, and it's the same thing. I mean, kids like to read about kids. They like to laugh. I have a series, iFunny. It's about a kid, you know, which right off the bat, that's a good title. It's like, I'll look at, what's that about? Which is always part of the game with anybody. It looks interesting. Let me pick it up. If you don't pick up the book, you will not buy it. So the first thing is pick it up. If it's not picked up, it will not be bought. And iFunny is about a kid who wants to be a stand-up comedian. What do you do when you want something? What's the little lesson for kids? Without making it a lesson, you have to study. So this kid studies every comedian, and he learns the lines, and he starts writing his own comedy. And in the first chapter of the book, and it's illustrated, and the illustrations are very funny, I think, and very cool. But in the first chapter, he's at the Funniest Kid in America, the local contest. And this is a kid who knows everything, but he's choking. And he's sweating. I mean, it's just the sweat is pouring out of his shoes, and visually. And because he's choking so badly, all he can remember are the punchlines. Can't remember the jokes, you know. So it goes like that. And then in the second chapter, he says, you know, I don't want to pull a big twist on you this early, but I can never be a stand-up comedian because he's in a wheelchair. And then we get into the whole thing of, one, how did that happen? Because he wasn't always in the wheelchair. And then what part does humor play in getting past some things, some bumps in life? Mm. And then what happened to him, and how did it help him? And, you know, so there's some, you know, some serious stuff for kids to think about. You know, on the face of it, kids don't want to read a book about a kid in a wheelchair. But this is a funny kid, and it's, you know, so kids get it, and they love the story.
When did you let your son start reading the thrillers?
Haven't still.
Still?
No, he's never. He read When the Wind Blows, which was where Maximum Ride came from, which was an adult book. But I don't think he's read any of the.
Would you be okay with teenagers reading the thrillers? Some of the violence, I don't know, adult stuff.
It depends. I remember one, and this has happened a few times. A woman came up and she's so proud, cutest little 9-10-year-old, and she read all the Alex Crosses, and I'm like, seriously? You know, what are you going to say? It's the parent and it's their deal, but I don't know, but, you know, how about Maximum Ride?
You know, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And why do you think, what's the appeal? Why do people read the thrillers? Why do people read? Sometimes there's some real violence in there. What do you think, is the essential appeal?
I think it's a mix. I think part of it is they're puzzles that people want to solve. I think that's a big part of it. I think that in my case, I mean, I'm really trying to get people involved with the hero and also the villain. I mean, I really want the villains to have some human characteristics and traits. I think that's important. I think that in life, a lot of times we don't get satisfactory endings. There are just so many of these cases where you go like, oh no, that's not what should happen. And oh my God, he did that and he got like 6 months suspended, or nothing happened. And I'm doing a true crime thing in Florida now where unbelievable what this guy did, this billionaire, and he got like a year. And I mean, So I think people like the fact that, you know, the endings are a little more satisfying. And they love the violence. No, I don't know.
We will get a chance for everybody here to ask a question or two, but the money you've put out there for independent bookstores,
yeah.
Why are you doing that? Why is that important?
I think there are two pieces to it. We did it in the United States, and then we did it in England, and it was very satisfying to me because the response was so great. And the one piece of it is, and it's not as bad here, but it could get terrible in a hurry. Amazon is very powerful in the United States, and they're very powerful in England. And that shut down a lot of stores, one being Borders as a chain, and then a lot of independent bookstores, because they just couldn't compete, and Amazon would sit there and sell books for nothing, practically. And how are you going to compete with that? And basically just drive stores out of business. I mean, my dream for Amazon is that Jeff Bezos wakes up some morning and he goes, you know, I'm going to change the way I'm looking at this thing, and our company, our public relations, our charity is going to be, we're going to really support reading.
Right.
Who knows? He's a bright guy, went to Princeton. His wife is a sweetheart. She actually went to the same prep school that Jack is at. So and nice kids and everything. So I hope that he'll just wake up one morning. And I've actually told him that. At least he laughed. And he has this weird laugh. But yeah, I'm not kidding. It's his high pitch. Very strange. At any rate, so I still have that dream that's what'll happen. But if it doesn't, you know, that hasn't happened here yet. They really haven't come. They haven't figured out Australia yet. But if they do, it's going to be trouble for bookstores here, for independents, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that bookstores are really important. I think it's really important that they're there, that we have a place to go, that we can touch books, that we can talk to people about books, that there's a community, that we can bring our kids to the store. It may be that 50 years from now, all of that will be done on the internet, but right now it isn't. Mm. You know, the internet has 50 Shades of Grey, okay, fine, but I mean, I don't see, you know, if Ulysses appeared in this day and age and it went out on the internet, they'd get the first 9 reviews, couldn't get through the first page, I agree, couldn't get through the first, you know, F, how did this piece of crap, F. And after a week, it would be gone. End of Ulysses. You know, it would just disappear, you know. So right now, bookstores are important. Publishers are important. You know, and Amazon has really squeezed publishers. Well, the problem with that is if publishers get squeezed and they have no money to give some advances to authors, I mean, how does Robert Caro sit there and write, you know, 3 volumes on LBJ or, you know, whatever, if nobody's supporting a little bit? I mean, it's going to take like 3 years to write the volume or, you know, whatever the heck it is. Or who's going to support those first couple of novels that don't make money so that the third novel comes and all of a sudden the publisher's, okay, we believed in you and we, you know, we mentored you and held your hand, et cetera, et cetera. So, and I don't think that apparatus is there right now. So if publishers get squeezed, if they don't have enough money, they're just not going to be able to do these things. And literature will I don't say it totally will disappear, but a lot of it will disappear. And that's it's just not great. We need books. We need people to read. This whole thing now where they're trying to get kids to channel into, figure out your occupation when you're in the 5th grade. I don't know. I don't think that's a great idea. And don't do anything else except think about being a nuclear physicist. You don't need to read. You don't need to do, you know, just, you know. Just a little, focus, okay, on something, and you might want to focus on something else next year, and, you know, But I think it's really important that that people read. I think stories are important. And even for scientists, I mean, you read about so many scientists. How did it all start? I used to read science fiction, and it got the brain going. It got the, you know, and then they got serious and interested. I don't know. So I think that's why.
That's a good reason. And just briefly, how do you want it to work with the independent bookstores? What do you want then? What do you hope that encourages with that money?
Well, I think on the local level, and I've seen this, the store, you know, if they get a grant, it's like, oh my God, this is so cool. Somebody's recognized that we're out here. It's really, really hard work. It doesn't pay terribly well. We're kind of missionaries. We love it, but you know, it's still very hard. I mean, you can't believe how hard it is to be stacking, you know, getting the books come in, the books come out every day. Here's another, you know, 1,000 books coming into the, you know, whatever. So it's a real pat on the back, and generally they're very appreciative and they feel that, and that's a wonderful thing. The people that go in there feel it. People in the town feel, I mean, the irony is people are very emotional about the, oh, I love that little store. They don't go in it. You got to go in it. You know, it's no good to just go, I love that store. That does not count for anything. I love that store, and I go in once a week, or I go in once a month, or, you know, whatever. Even to smell the books, okay, that's a start. Maybe someday you'll buy one. So that's good. It also, on the local level, when they it gives them the opportunity to get a little local press, yeah, which is very hard for stores to get. So more people are aware, and they go, oh, well, I haven't been in there in a while. Oh, yeah, I forgot, you know, and so that helps. And then on this level, or, you know, I've done some interviews, quite a few, actually. This was so boring, this radio show. You know? but it allows to shine a light,
sure,
on the problem, and the problem being one, independent bookstores, and let's make sure that they survive and prosper and we're paying attention to them. And the other thing is getting kids reading, which is so vital. And in this country, I don't know if this is totally accurate, but the number I was given is 30% of high school students here are functionally illiterate. Worse than the United States, you know, just as bad in England, but you know, that's not good. It's not good for these kids, obviously. And it's not good for the society, because eventually society is going to have to carry the weight of a lot of these kids who are going to, some of them will get in trouble, some of them won't be able to find decent jobs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And some of that could disappear. And as I said, the thing about reading is we can actually affect that. It's not going to solve it, but we can really affect it.
Make a difference.
Yeah.
Can you... just before we get on to questions, can you give us...
Can I dance? Can I sing?
Yeah, I'd love it if you sang, because I can't sing at all. But can you
give My name is O'Hanlon, and I just turned 16. My home is in Ireland. Yeah.
That's great.
That's it.
That's great. I just wanted
That's all I know. That's it.
Yeah. But it was in tune, delivered beautifully.
I know that one rap thing. No, I won't.
Beatboxing. Can you just give us a preview? What is coming up that hasn't come out yet? What sort of books can we look forward to?
Well, the store, that weird one. You know, I every year around November, December, Alex appears on our under our trees. What else?
I'm after tasty tidbits from plot lines that might... I don't know.
Well, I think, you know, it's if you have kids or grandkids, just... peek at some of these kids. I have a lot of kids' books. Just go, you read a couple of chapters, and you go, you know what? I like this, and they would like this. You know, in the kids' area, Treasure Hunters is pretty cool, because my promise there is this is about kids who their parents are treasure and actually treasure hunters around the world, and for whatever reasons the parents disappear and the kids decide they're going to continue with this treasure hunting all around the world. And my promise to kids and parents and teachers or whatever is, if you follow the series, the kids will visit every continent, and so you'll get a flavor for Africa, you'll get a flavor for Europe, you'll get, you know, while you're being entertained. So that's a neat one to just kind of peek at. iFunny, I talked about, which I think is... it is funny, and it's a great thing. I mean, my thing about books for kids is I want them to get a book that when they finish it, they go, give me another book. That really is crucial. And the worst thing is to give them books and they finish it and they go, I hate books. You know, and we do that, and they do it in the schools more than they need to. Yes, you know, it shouldn't be all fun and games, but some fun and games so that they can go, oh yeah, I like some books. You know, I mean, I swear to God, when I went to Catholic school, I don't think there was anything we liked. it was just all this dismal stuff, and you just went, oh my God, I don't like, you know. Yeah, and what else? I don't know what else.
That's okay. We'll keep an eye on them around in the lobby.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
James is going to take some questions and sign some books, but if we can all thank you.
Together, we're going to do it.
Yeah, we're going to do it together.
As a parent, we're not allowed to have favourite children, but as an author, I'm sure you're allowed to have a favourite character.
I do have a favourite child.
You do?
Well, I only have one, so it's easy.
I've got two, and I'm wondering which one's your favourite, Alex Cross or Michael Bennett?
I do think parents probably do have favourites, even though we kind of don't want to admit it. Kids, you know. I think, love them all, but I think somehow we do have favourites. But in terms of the books, there's a lot of things that I'm happy to have done. I'm happy to have created Alex Cross. The Women's Murder Club, I think that's a unique kind of approach to crime fiction, you know, which tends to be lone wolf men, lone wolf women. And there you have four women, you know, who were collaborating, which I think is kind of cool and accurate. Maximum Ride, I'm very happy to have created that. Rape Catch a Dorian in the middle school book. So there's a lot of, you know, sort of, I guess I shouldn't praise myself by saying archetypal characters, but, you know, I'm happy to have created all of that kind of thing.
No favorite?
No, I mean, Alex is the closest to me as a, you know, he's very... conscientious, and he's family oriented and all that. But I'm as Max is important as is important to me, and some of the kids stuff. And always, I mean, whatever you're working on, the new stuff, that always, I'm doing a series, or at least one book, I don't know if it'll be a series now, about boys and the way they become bad boys, but it's humorous, and how it happens, and how we can prevent that, and verbal bullying, which I think is much worse than physical bullying in terms of leaving scars on kids. I wrote one of the middle school books. I forget what the hell it's called. It has broccoli in the title, but my title was Summer the Booger Eater, and it was about summer camp and this one kid who had been labeled the booger eater when he was like 4 years old. And he's 11 and 12, and they're still calling him the booger eater, you know. And he becomes best friends with Rafe. And Rafe kind of sort of, in his own clumsy way, rescues this kid from this verbal, terrible name that he's been given, you know. And there's all these funny things about, you know, there's cartoons about, you know, this guy, like, going in for a job interview, and the guy goes, I'm not going to hire a booger eater. And you know, and then him getting married, and do you booger eater take, you know, whatever. You know. And how these things just kind of follow you through life. But anyway, I don't know what that had to do with the question.
That's okay.
Who cares? Oh, is Alex or Ben? I don't know. I like them both.
why don't we start over here?
Hi. I'm just curious about your beginnings. I mean, we know who you are, and we
baby.
See... No.
Right, I was writing when I was one.
In your writing, your very beginnings. We see who you are now in the trail of books you have. But can you take us to your beginning experience, your very first step?
We talked about the mental hospital. I mean, just reading, and then starting to scribble. No. Come back to the mic.
She wants more.
Help
she wants
me out.
More. Do you want to know when he first started putting stories together?
I want to hear a little bit about your stepping into the publishing industry, that first experience.
The 31 turndowns of the Thomas Berryman number? That? I think the first thing is, you know, every short story I ever submitted was rejected, and form letters. And then the first book, 31 Turndowns, and then it wins an Edgar as the best first mystery. And I still keep the name of all the editors. And you know, and that's very painful. And I remember, in terms of the Edgar I was working on, I got this phone call, and this woman said, "You know, you've been nominated for an Edgar," and she hadn't been able to locate me. I don't know why, but. And she says, "It's Friday night at the Commodore Hotel." And I said, "Oh, gee, I can't come." She said, "No, you've been nominated. You have to come." I said, "I'm really sorry. I don't remember what, but there was some reason I couldn't go." And then she finally said, "You have to come. You won." And so I said, "Okay, well, I'm there. I'm coming." And I went with my parents, which was wonderful. And I was, you know, I was 26, I was a kid. I was very, very lucky to, one, have got the book published, and then, especially after all the turndowns, and then to win this award. And I remember that when I got up on the stage, and I was very shy in those days, and you had to do a little acceptance speech, and all I said was, I guess I'm a writer now, you know. And I think when you're writing stuff and you haven't been published, you know, if somebody asks you, you know, like, what do you do? And you go, "I'm a writer." And they go, "Oh, what have you published?" And if you haven't published anything, they look at you like you're a nutcase. You know what I mean? I mean, it's just crazy. I mean, no, I'm a writer. That's what I do. I write, and no, you can't be a writer. You haven't been published, which is unfortunate. So I think that's part of the process. You know, and some of us get lucky. I mean, John Grisham, his first book, A Time to Die, which I think is one of his best, and that got turned down by everybody in New York. Got published finally by a tiny little publisher in New Jersey, sold nothing, and yet it was a very good commercial novel. And I don't mean to diminish it by saying commercial novel, which I write. Okay, who's next? Is that okay?
Blonde I'll start lady. Over there on that side.
Yeah. Yeah.
You keep mentioning Ulysses. I just wanted to know if you actually finished it, and if Ulysses? So, how long?
Yeah. No, I've read it a couple of times, actually, and I've read Moby Dick, I think, 4 times. The first time, it was a very painful experience. I don't know why with Ulysses. I think that was sort of like, you know, people that run the Iron Man thing, and they just go, "I'm going to do it. I'm going to finish it. I'm going to," you know. I once was in university, and the best course I ever had was in graduate school, and it was so terrific. And I went to this professor, and I said, "You know, can we take just you and I?" And you know, you were allowed to do that in graduate school. And I said, "What I'd love to do is," I gave him a list. I said, "Here's about 50 books that I haven't gotten to now yet, and if it would be great if we could co-select. You know, a number of those." And so we just selected, I don't know what the number was, 15, and that was the course. And in a way you could kind of do that, even if students were picking all different novels or whatever, you could still then just talk about the novel in general and have them write papers about whatever book they were writing. And I think it would be a very stimulating, I think kids would love that course, where they got to kind of pick the books that excited them, rather than everybody's going to read The Scarlet Letter or whatever, you know.
Sorry, we've got another one up there. We'll keep on going around.
Yeah.
Hi. I was just going to ask what your plan was for the
plans?
Private.
I have no plans.
No plan. No, I mean, like, your premise for the rest of the private offices, the private series with Jack.
One of the ideas I had, Private has offices, it's an investigative company, and they have offices all over the world. And when I was doing that, and I tend to be kind of like, "Oh, what about? I said, "It would be kind of cool if I could go, you know, to all of the publishers who publish me around the world and go, I'd like you to sort of do a local version, and I'll be involved to some extent, and not as much as I am with the co-writing thing where I'm, you know, selecting the authors, but I will be involved." So we did one here, and another one's coming out in August. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
August. We did a private Paris, and we've done 2 private Londons now. We're doing a private Rio, which is going to come out next year, which deals with both the World Cup and the Olympics, messing up both of those events, as only I can do it. So, you know, that's what kind of started that idea of, you know, let's do private in as many cities as I can, which was kind of fun. Did a private India, which was really fun to do as well. Yeah.
Another question down here.
Hi. I was just having a think before I came, which books were my favorite, and the ones that had the...
So you're asking a question of yourself.
Yeah, pretty much.
Excellent.
I forgot my question. Oh, yeah. It got me thinking that my favourite ones are the ones with the really interesting evil characters like Kyle Craig and the Weasel and the Wolf and all that. And I was just wondering what inspires you to write those kind of evil characters?
My wife. She actually creates the really baddies, you know, Kyle Craig and Gary Sinise and, you know, da 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 da. It's funny, with like Gary Sinise, you know, when they were doing Along Came a Spider, that, you know, they called up the screenwriter and says, well, how do you pronounce that? And I said, Gary Sinise. He said, oh, thank you very much. And then the movie, Gary Sonji. Okay. Thanks for asking anyway. The thing I try to do, even though the villains tend to be over the top, and certainly in terms of what they do, but I like them to be human, identifiably human. I mean, villains are so weird anyway. You know, I just like watching the first Hannibal Lecter movie, you know, and he's this horrible, horrible man that skins people, does all these bizarre things to people. And here's this psychiatrist who works at the prison, and Hannibal doesn't like him, okay, you know, and the guy kind of leers a little bit at Jodie Foster when she comes to the prison. Not a major thing, but little. And at the end of the movie, we find out that Hannibal's going to track this guy down and kill him, and the whole audience is like cheering. What is that all about? What craziness, you know? Because we love Hannibal Lecter, you know. It's horrifying serial killer. And then there's this poor shrink who's like a little, you know, vile, but minor vile, you know. Oh, Hannibal's going to get his ass. Yeah. Did that totally ignore your question?
Okay. Over here?
Yeah.
I'm a huge fan of the Women's Murder Club.
You're really not that big, I don't think. You're not even as big as...
I can put heels on.
Okay, all right. Okay.
Huge fan of Women's Murder Club and wanted to see how or where you think there is going to be an end or just going to keep going and with, you know, Lindsay and however... Yeah,
yeah, that's always an interesting question. I mean, with Maximum Ride, I finally ended it. And then I went, oh, you know, I have one more idea. So I there's one more coming out next year, Maximum Ride Forever. Clever end title, right? Yeah. I still have things to say about him. One of the things about the series is when you're writing, you know, that adventure fiction is, they have to move along, or I feel they have to move along. So you never fully develop the character, but over a number of books, you really can. You know, so we know a lot about Alex now. We know a lot about his family and his grandmother and, you know, da 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 da. And the same with the Women's Murder Club. We know a lot about Lindsay and Yuki and, you know, da da da. So I still have more to say about them. So as long as that's the situation, you know, I like to keep the series going. Private might be in a little danger, but, you know. Unless I can think about more about Jack and round him more so that I'm, you know, get even more interested in him.
Just got time for a couple more questions. Up the top there.
Hi, thank you very much. Firstly,
that weird little mirror there. We can look at ourselves. That's so cool. Let's just look at ourselves.
I think that's
now.
Actually a TV teleprompter.
Oh, is it? That's so cool. Hi. Hello, Jimmy. How are you? I'm sorry. Go ahead. Yeah.
Firstly, thank you very much for being a champion for independent bookstores. I love those as well. My question to you is a bit about process. If you could tell us how you do the research for your writing, and in particular, your books are set all over the world and in all sorts of genres. So I'm wondering how you do the research to get to that.
Well, I think part of it is now. I mean, the way the internet, you really can get a lot of information that was used to be difficult to get at, but you can really, you know, there's so much information. It's right at your fingertips now. So that's a piece of it. The other thing is, I mean, I have. I don't know, a few people now who I can go to for research and pay them, and they will do it. So if it's, you know, Hawaii, I might go do it myself. And if it's a crack house in the Bronx, I might have one of my researchers do that one. sort of like that. Yeah, I don't know if that helps, but there really is. There's so much available now on the internet. It's so much easier than it used to be.
Okay. Yeah. And final question, Danny.
You talked before about stepping back from your ideas and choosing one, and that being kind of one of the things you were good at, or one of your strengths. Is there something that gets you over the line? Is there a particular thing that gets you over the line with regards to an idea? And if there is there something you do when you get there? Do you stop what you're doing in your tracks and like write it at the time, or do you just hope you'll still remember when you get to your desk?
There seem to be a lot of questions in there, kind of. One of them is, in terms of, like waking up in the night and writing stuff down. I don't do that anymore because I would read these things and go, what? And I find that if it's really a good idea, I tend to actually remember it. So I'm not paranoid about that anymore. But in terms of settling on an idea, I mean, I'll tend to maybe settle on a couple of possible ideas. And they'll tend to be just a one-line thing. And then I'll stare at them and I start to, what am I more emotional about? And then start to write an outline, just maybe, some scenes. And is this, do I feel that this is going anywhere? And sometimes I'll stop on that one and go, I'm not getting it yet, so I'll maybe look at something else. I've done a couple of outlines where at the end of it I go, I don't really want to write this book. That's only happened one or two times where I just go, I don't know if that's helpful. One more question. Yeah. Hi, good.
James, can you talk to us a little bit about how you balance the fragility or the weaknesses of a character and their strengths? And is it difficult to know when not to push that too far?
That sounds like an English teacher question. Once again, it's just emotional for me. And the same thing happens when you're trying to put together a TV series, when you're, you talk about our friends or our relatives or whatever. There's like a few things that make them who they are for us. I mean, a lot of times, especially long fiction, where everything about this character. You know more about this character than you know about your spouse, much more. So I tend not to do that. I tend to look for those things that corresponds to the way we really feel about people. We know some things. And then what are the things that would really make us interested in that character? If you're talking to somebody and they start talking, you're kind of like you're looking over their shoulder, they're not getting you interested yet. You're not trying to be cruel, but it just isn't. So what are the things that sort of make that person? Like with Alex, who's an African-American, we meet him and he's on his porch in the first, Along Came a Spider, and he's playing Gershwin. And we know he's an African-American, we know he's a detective, and he's playing Gershwin, and I'm kind of, okay, I'm interested. And by the end of the first chapter, we find out, three or four things about him where it's kind of like, I want to read the next chapter, And the vulnerability, same thing. I mean, it's just a matter of I tend to write relatively strong characters and strong women in particular. So I'm not as big on the vulnerabilities. I probably should do more of that, but Okay.
Thank you, everyone. Let's thank James Patterson.